Turkish side of border, the Turkish side of border, what's going on there, and what are the main problems, and what we are trying to do. It's actually a regional planning practice we have done there in Thrace region. Basically, first we start working about planning of Istanbul. I work in Istanbul Metropolitan Planning Center. Then we realized that actually to study the plan of Istanbul itself, it doesn't mean really that we are going to sort out the problem, because Istanbul is affecting almost all Anatolia, almost all Thrace regions. So that's why we got an agreement with, as a metropolitan municipality, we got an agreement with the central government. It used to be called, because it changed now, used to be called Forest and Environmental Ministry. And then also there is an association, it's called Thrace Development Association. All the governors in this place and the municipalities are the member of this association. So there were a protocol, an agreement among those institutions. So, if we have a look at the region, actually it's a transition point between Europe and Anatolia. I'm sure all of you know very well. Just to show where the region is. And if we look at the geographical position a little bit further, then we will see how it's closed with Alexandroupolis, with Greece, and also it is, this area is a peninsula surrounded by Black Sea, Marmara Sea, and Aegean Sea. There are three provinces in the region, namely Edirne, Tekirdağ, and Kırklareli. There are in these provinces, there are 60 towns and almost 700 villages. So in Turkey, administratively, we don't have a regional administrations. We have only provinces. And 81 provinces in Turkey, three of them in this area, in this region. So the area is about 1.9 million hectare, and there are nearly 1.9 million inhabitants, and some of the Turkish agriculture production is coming from this region, especially sunflower and rice production. But also wheat production. It takes quite important place within the whole country. The economic facts, also the industry is growing here in this region since probably the 80s, 1980s. And that's why the 25% of workforce is working in industry, 40% of them in agriculture, and 35% of them in service sector. So, and area, whole area, 27% is forest land. 60% agricultural land. The main problem, actually, I'm going to talk about that, the region, old region, is in two parts. One part is losing the population. The population is decreasing. And one part is receiving population, immigrants, and population growth rate is quite high. So basically the area growing is this area. It's growing because of the industry, and the coast area, it starts from Istanbul until almost Enes, let's say, Alexandropolis, or the Evros River, the border. So it is growing because of the summer houses. And this area, in the winter, it's almost 800,000 people, but in the summer, it becomes double. It's about 1.5 million inhabitants in this coast area. Of course, probably as you know, this is a big pressure from Istanbul province, because Istanbul still is growing dramatically. There are 14 million people, which is 18% of Turkish population live here. And now the province doesn't allow all the development. So that's for development attempts. So that's why, and now the development of industry, development of construction start going around Istanbul, start making pressure around Istanbul. And first, of course, in Tekirdağ, in the western side, in Thrace region, and in the eastern side, it's Kocaeli, another province. This is very brief information about the process, about the region. And again, very brief information, when it starts and why. It starts actually after the 80s. After 80s, this is a breaking point for Turkish process, development process, economically. And also, politically, it starts some changes as well. First of all, tourism incentive law. It's acted in 1982. And after that, development law. Tourism incentive law gives some encourage to the tourism to build up, basically, first of all, in the coast areas, but at the end, everywhere. I mean, we had a period that if you make a tourism investment, you can do everything. It's your right. You are developing the country, so you are free, basically. And you are supported by the central government. So that was one of the reasons of this construction process. And the other one is 1985 development law. Development law is, until that time, planning process was under the authority of central government. After this year, central government gave some of the planning authority to the local governments, to the municipalities. And the municipalities, of course, they didn't have an experience of planning, they didn't have enough organization to plan all this area. So that's why they have done quite a lot of mistake as well. So, and the other one, is Coastal Law number 3621. So this is just brief information because I think Professor Yenen is going to give a lot of information about this law as well. The information about law, I think. So this is just quick information. And then if we look at the region, as I said before, region has got naturally two important problems. One of them, because of the industry, this basin, this river, it's called Ergene River, and it becomes, at the end, it becomes Evros River, and it reaches your Evros Delta. So, this river polluted by the industry around Tekirdağ. And there are at the moment five existing dams and 55 existing ponds. These are another ecologically sensitive places, and some of them really under risk of pollution by the industry, because these are basically very important points for all the agricultural activities in the region. So this is the area under the threat of industrial zone, but also there are not only the rivers, but also the ground underground water is under the threat of industry production and pollution as well. So here, as we see, there are three big zones has got potential underground water. And if we have a look at just quick look all of the area, this zone is one of the zone losing the population, and this one as well. These are mostly agricultural zones. This zone is under the threat of industrial and building pressure, and the population growing very fast, almost 5% per year. The average of population growth rate in Turkey is 1.7, but here it's growing 5% per year. And the other one, mass coastal zone usage, basically the summer houses, they are coming from Istanbul and they are coming from the industrial zone to construct summer houses here in the south of the region, basically the coast of Marmara and the coast of the Aegean Sea. So, for us, the important thing to have a plan, vision, and together with the local people, together with the NGOs, together with the administrations, that we did this vision sentence almost all together. So the sentence was basically developing Thrace sub-region while protecting unique cultural and natural identity in perspective of environmental, social, economical sustainability principles by facilitating local potentials and natural assets in order to be competitive in the global economy. Because the main main argument was, okay, we try to preserve the area, but we also try to develop the area in order to be competitive. And the planning principles, it was basically sustainability, rural development, limiting industrial development, setting functional linkages. And our planning objectives were protecting forests, protecting agricultural lands, protecting meadows, protecting water resources, decentralizing mass populated areas, limiting industrial development, converting existing industrial structure, because some of the existing industry, they really have very dangerous production and very dangerous pollution for the soil contaminated and the river. So that's why we also propose to convert some of the existing industry as well and developing eco-friendly economic activities in the rural areas. So that's why we have proposed a basin management model. Within this basin management model, there was waste management model, limiting development pressure, disabling polluting industrial sectors, disabling water consuming industrial sectors. And if, in order to protect agricultural lands, increase harvest diversity, different agricultural building conditions according to the different cultural classifications, waste management, agricultural plants, creation larger agricultural lots. And the main tools that we propose, organized agricultural centers, or organized agricultural sub-centers. This is basically here around the region that losing its population. So in order to keep the people there and in order to develop their economy by using agriculture. And forest areas, these areas actually we have already a law to protect these national zones, but these zones also losing, especially the north side, not the seaside, but north side, losing the population. So we also proposed here some eco-friendly soft sectors such as ecotourism, local trade, and developing livestock, etc. At the end, we try to make some functional linkage in terms of the cities and towns. And that's why some of the towns, we proposed service centers, some of them tourism, some of them rural centers, and we try to limit the industry here in the existing place. It was, of course, a big debate, this part, because some people, they didn't like this idea, because they say if industry develop here, our land becomes much more valuable, and we earn a lot of money. Why you try to stop it? And some of them, they say, of course, we are agree with them. They say, okay, they are producing industry here, but all the region, almost all the region, are under threat of this pollution, even up to story, even up to Ennis. As you know, this area has also rice production. So even this western side is affected by the industry here in eastern part.
Sorry, it doesn't move forward.
Yeah, it's just almost finished. Yeah, almost finished.
Rice
production. Yeah, rice production. So that was briefly our planning methods and planning objectives, etc. But also we knew that we should consider and we should study this together with Istanbul. So that's why in this center, in Istanbul Metropolitan Planning Center, we studied this subject. Here, I think some details, but anyway, the other thing I can tell that in these three provinces and 60 towns, we had in 3.5 or 4 years time, we had more than 350 meetings with the local people, with the administrators, with the politicians, etc., etc. And that was really much more difficult. This process was much more difficult than Istanbul. Right, at the end we reached a plan. So the plan was, these slides. So we also try to work with all the region, because it's in Marmara region. So in the Marmara region, the industrial zones and the ecologically sensitive zones, etc. And especially one of the important objectives of plan in Istanbul was to slow down the population growth rate in Istanbul and in Marmara region. Because if we don't manage to do this, actually we will not be able to successful neither for Istanbul nor for Thrace region. So these are the work about all the region, Marmara region, and finally at the end, 2.5 years ago, the plan was approved by the Ministry of. I'm sorry, because 2 years ago, this name of this ministry was Environmental and Forest Ministry. Now it's Environmental and Urbanization. Yeah, so that's why I'm sometimes a little bit confused. So this is the briefly our work there, but since the beginning of this conference, I noticed once more the importance of cross-border study for the environment once again. So that's why we start working about that, but it's just locally, and we haven't got any connection with the others. I hope this conference will be also a good opportunity to have this cross-border work as well. Eforistum, thank you.
Thank you very much. Are there any questions, please? The lady first.
You showed a slide with verbal data. Can you just show it again?
No, you have to wait for the microphone.
Yeah, but it's just to show it.
Yeah, but I cannot show it.
This one?
Before that.
Before?
Yes, much before, I think. I don't know.
Data? I thought you were asking date.
Verbal, you talked about verbal showing.
This one. This one?
Before.
Before?
Yeah.
This one?
This one?
Yes.
Okay.
What do you mean by verbal data? I mean, the discussions that were going on, you also recorded them. Is that what you mean?
Yes, almost all of them. But first of all, we start also about 40 people, maybe 50 people, because sometimes it could change. We start working in the field as well, and we start collecting all the data from all 70, there are 75 municipalities, and all of them, they have their own master plan, because as I told you, after 1985, with the development law, they start studying, they start approving their own plan without any collaboration with the others. So that's why we didn't know who has got the plan and what is their proposed, how is their plan for the industry, for the construction, for the population.
Okay, but who did you invite? Did you also invite, for example, historians or storytellers who knew the area and who had knowledge that is neither found in books or in maps?
Ah, yes. Yes, we that's right. We had also a workshop together with academicians and together with politicians and some people who knows the story. We had this workshop in the Metropolitan Center, Metropolitan Planning Center. It was, yeah, and experts to get all the information from the background.
Okay. And we're doing something similar, but we're trying to involve all types of people that can contribute, not just the experts or the politicians. We're also trying to involve the local people who have been living there for many years, decades, centuries, who have a lot of knowledge of the area. This is what we're trying to do in
I agree with you. For us, actually, I don't know if really we were successful for this process or not, because we have also a lot of critics. I mean, this is the first project work that we had 350 meetings. Before, I used to work as a planner, and still actually the process going on like that. So we make the plan, and we have we open to public for 1 month. If you don't like, you give us a letter, which part you don't like. So we get these letters, we read it. If we think that you are right, we just change it. Otherwise, nothing. You can go to the court. We used to work like this. And now, first time, we start working with the public, and it was very difficult for us and for the local people as well, because for them it was firstly to join a meeting and to see a plan and to their ask their opinion. So that's why for them also it was a new experience. And some of them, they were really exaggerating. They were saying that, okay, if you invite me here, you do what I say. The others, it's not my problem. Just do what I say. So anyway, I think this is a process. It's a process, yeah. I mean, we are learning as a planners, and they are also the public is learning.
Thank you very much, Professor Valenis.
It's okay. Well, thanks for the presentation. It was very interesting. And what strikes me is that it is exactly the same period that we had regional plans in both sides, sort of revision of regional plan we had in France, and we still have it, and there is no plan from the other side. Well, wouldn't be, I mean, what would you think? Is there a potential to have some sort of, at least at the beginning, observers to see from the one side what is planned from the other side and start some sort of cooperation? I believe that on the formal level, this could be not, let's say, this is the right one, but in the informal level, between, let's say, the ones who do the projects that are planned, etc., etc., we have to work towards this direction, because it seems that we do have the same objectives, and since this area is quite sensitive, a joint effort would give much better outputs.
Exactly. I agree with you. We have the same objectives. We have the same problems, especially I saw from your presentation. I was just talking to my friend. I mean, these problems almost, he's talking about our problems. That much similar. And I think we have, Zeka is going to talk about that, trace city associations in England. Tarkakent, yeah. It could be a very good tool to have this the collaboration. I mean, it's not necessarily to be just formal. Just informally, you can come to see what's going on there, what we are doing, and we can come here to see what's going on here and what you are doing. So just to briefly, to give us, to exchange some information. And I think it's going to be very useful for the planners of both sides.
Right, thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. This has been very fruitful. Is there any other question?
Thanks a lot.
Can we get a reaction to this from, and that was Costas from that was Costas from the Lenis and Costas from the Lenis. From Kavala and Volos, but how practical is this suggestion for the Alexandroupolis area?
Συνεργασία ή τη επικοινωνία μεταξύ των δύο πλευρών.
Hold on, Frank Costa, συγγνώμη. Ένα λεπτό, hold on, for people to wear their headphones. No, no, hold on, just, okay, is everybody, okay, go on, okay.
Το ζήτημα που έχει τεθεί όσον αφορά την συνεργασία ή την επικοινωνία των δύο πλευρών μεταξύ τόσο της Ελλάδας όσο και της Τουρκίας στα θέματα του σχεδιασμού ή του προγραμματισμού ή της προστασίας γενικότερα του περιβάλλοντος, θα μπορούσαμε να πούμε ότι είναι μάλλον ένας στόχος τον οποίο θα έχουμε πρέπει να έχουμε και δύο πλευρές. Τα προβλήματα που έχουμε εντοπίσει μέχρι στιγμής, ή τουλάχιστον το θέσω αλλιώς, το τι έχει γίνει μέχρι τώρα. Εκεί που υπάρχει μία μικρή συνεργασία και υπάρχουν προοπτικές να εξελιχθεί και να γίνει μια πάρα πολύ σοβαρή προσπάθεια, είναι ακριβώς κατά μήκος του ευρωπαϊκού και κυρίως για το θέμα των πλημμυρών και των νερών. Εκεί ήδη έχουμε συστήσει μια επιτροπή τόσο με τη Βουλγαρία όσο και με την Τουρκία. Οπότε κάτι έχει ξεκινήσει να γίνει. Κάτι έχει ξεκινήσει να γίνει.
It was translated as landing.
About
floodings.
Floods. Flooding. Για τις πλημμύρες. Γι' αυτό έχει ξεκινήσει μια συνεργασία. Τα προβλήματα που τίθενται είναι τα εξής. Υπάρχει θέμα του ποιοι φορείς θα είναι αυτοί οι οποίοι θα αναλάβουν τη συνεργασία αυτή. Η ως τώρα εμπειρία έχει να κάνει με το εξής, ότι οι φορείς οι οποίοι έχουν αναλάβει να συνεργαστούν ή να συμμετέχουν σε ανάλογες κοινές ομάδες δράσης και κοινές ομάδες εργασίας είναι σε υψηλό επίπεδο. Και όταν λέω υψηλό επίπεδο, εννοώ τα υπουργεία, τα αντίστοιχα υπουργεία. Υπάρχει πολύ μεγάλη ένωση των τοπικών αρχών και των τοπικών αυτοδιοικήσεων. Αυτό είναι ένα ζήτημα διαχειριστικό, γιατί πολλές φορές οι τοπικές αυτοδιοικήσεις είναι αυτές οι οποίες θα κληθούν σε κάθε περίπτωση να αναλάβουν δράση σε οποιοδήποτε ζήτημα ή σε οποιοδήποτε πρόβλημα. Τώρα, στο κομμάτι του σχεδιασμού, όπως τέθηκε, δηλαδή των σχεδίων που πρέπει να εγκριθούν ή κατά τη διάρκεια της έγκρισής τους, αν είναι καλό να υπάρχει μια συνεργασία ακόμα και σε επίπεδο παρατηρητών, πιστεύω ότι θα ήταν μια εξαιρετικά καλή αρχή αυτό το πράγμα. Δηλαδή να δούμε από κάθε πλευρά το τι έχουμε στο μυαλό μας, τι σχεδιάζουμε και πού προσπαθούμε να πάμε. Ποια είναι η προοπτική και των δύο πλευρών, τόσο της περιφέρειας της Ανατολικής Μακεδονίας και Θράκης από την πλευρά της Ελλάδος, όπως και της περιφέρειας, όπως μας έδειξε πριν ο Τούρκος συνάδελφος. Αυτά για την ιστορία της όλης διαδικασίας συνεργασίας. Υπάρχουν πάρα πολλά πράγματα που πρέπει να γίνουν, πιστεύω. Σήμερα τουλάχιστον είναι μια καλή αρχή, γιατί πέρα από το γεγονός ότι θα γνωριστούμε, θα θέσουμε και κάποια ζητήματα τόσο διαστημοριακής συνεργασίας και ειδικότερα όσον αφορά την παράκτεια περιοχή, και ίσως αυτό το πράγμα να συνεχιστεί και να το κάνουμε και ευρύτερο και πιο σημαντικό και πιο ολοκληρωμένο.
Now we'll move on to the next presentation from Professor Zeki Yeh Gelen and Dr. Erkan.